Ties that bind Estonia and the United States as allies are vitally important, and they are rock solid. But there's much more to our broad and multifaceted relationship, which is particularly of interest to this fine institution. So let's turn to business. Estonia's political stability and fiscal security have underpinned its economic development success since regaining independence. I'm always pleased when I hear leaders of the American Chamber of Commerce here thank visiting U.S. congressional delegations for continued security assistance to Estonia. Business leaders recognize that Estonia's economic success depends in no small part on peace within its borders. And Estonia's economic prosperity is also closely linked to stability and growth in its wider European neighborhood. Your businesses do better when there's growth in Finland, Sweden, Germany, and other markets in the region. It's no surprise that Estonia, a small and open economy, enthusiastically embraced a prospective free trade agreement between the United States and the European Union. With only 1.3 million consumers in its domestic market, Estonia and its business leaders need to think about an export-led growth model from a very early stage. And steps to reduce barriers to entering other markets can go a long way to help Estonian small businesses. Earlier this month, I was honored to hand out the first Transatlantic Business of the Year award. This awards program is a new initiative that the embassy launched in cooperation with the American Chamber of Commerce and the Baltic American Freedom Foundation. We recognize Estonian companies that are succeeding in the challenging US market, and we also recognize individuals who are supporting the entrepreneurship ecosystem in Estonia. At the awards ceremony a few weeks ago, your former foreign minister and current member of parliament, my friend Kate Pentus-Vesmanis, told the audience about growing up in Soviet-occupied Estonia. Kate said that it was no surprise that Estonians, who had to stand in long queues for the chance to buy ration products, have embraced open market economics. I too remember long queues from my days as a young diplomat serving in the German Democratic Republic and the Soviet Union. In fact, whenever my wife or I saw a queue outside of the store, we'd immediately hop into the back of it just to see if something interesting was available to purchase. This was long before Stockmann's opened in St. Petersburg or Gallery Lafayette opened in the eastern part of Berlin. Europe's come so far. Now we have the problem of too many choices in our stores, and not even just in our stores, because you can get just about anything online these days. Of course, online itself has a completely different meaning than Kate and I were experiencing in the old days. By opening our markets, we provide new opportunities both for businesses and consumers, and we allow information and innovation to flourish. Let's come back to this topic of a US-EU free trade agreement. As you probably know, the two sides spent more than 3 years negotiating a transatlantic trade and investment partnership agreement, the famous TTIP. The goal of this free trade agreement was to forge an ambitious, comprehensive agreement to eliminate all tariffs, make US and EU regulations more compatible, and remove barriers to trade for small and medium-sized enterprises. TTIP is unfortunately in a holding pattern. The new administration is reviewing it, and we've heard some positive signals from US economic and congressional leaders that there remains strong interest in pursuing a trade deal. And many of the hardest topics have already seen much progress. We hope all that work will be used to good purpose. I'd like to highlight a couple of important points on TTIP. First, the underlying rationale for a US-EU trade agreement remains very strong. The EU and the United States are each other's most important economic markets. We are each other's largest trade and investment partners. Transatlantic trade flows average nearly $4.8 billion every day in 2016. There's nearly $4.5 trillion worth of investment stock between transatlantic partners. and 15 million jobs in the EU and the United States are directly supported by transatlantic trade and investment. Clearly, the transatlantic commercial relationship is an important source of economic prosperity for both Europe and the United States. Continuing to work together to lower tariff and non-tariff barriers will help sustain this prosperity. So I believe we have an economic incentive to come back to the negotiating table in some form in the near to medium term. Second, we cannot look at any trade deal from an exclusively economic viewpoint. Political winds in both the United States and many European capitals played a role in stalling negotiations. We got bogged down in disputes over marketing feta cheese and Parma ham. We became overrun with myths about chlorinated chicken. And we lost sight of the big picture, that free and fair trade creates more prosperity, that the United States and the European Union have the highest health, safety, environmental and labor standards in the world, that our small businesses are more profitable when they export, and that trade enables new, better paying jobs for our citizens. So where do we go from here with TTIP, or whatever new acronym we invent to describe a future US-EU trade agreement? First, I think we need to take the time to remind citizens on both sides of the Atlantic about the broad benefits of trade and investment cooperation for average citizens. We need to remind ourselves that while we do disagree on some important details, we are in close agreement on many, if not most, of the important fundamentals that surround free trade. And we need business people, not politicians or diplomats, frankly, to take the lead in this public outreach. We need Estonian companies to tell their story about the importance of transatlantic trade for their supply chains, their workforce, their bottom line. Companies like Estonia Piano, which exports the majority of its stock to the United States and currently faces a 4% tariff. Small business like Datel Ovella, which looks forward to fewer non-tariff barriers as they provide digital solutions to US cities and states. Large German manufacturers like BMW, which not only exports cars to the United States, but is the largest automotive exporter from the United States. And we need you, current and future Estonian Business School entrepreneurs, to raise your voice and explain how trade has contributed to Estonia's economic success and remains vital to your future. It should be no surprise that I'm an optimist when it comes to the future of US-EU trade and investment relations. I've lived in times when trade was not free and not fair, and I, for one, don't want to go back to those days of joining a queue in the hopes of getting some fresh cheese. When President Trump traveled to Brussels this past May, he agreed with President Juncker to establish a US-EU joint action plan on trade issues. I'm confident that we'll get back to on the general path of US-EU cooperation on trade issues. As I look to the future, I want to highlight one additional economic arena where I see great opportunity, but also potential turbulence on the road ahead. To borrow a phrase from The Economist, data is the new oil of the global economy. Data is the fuel of our future, and it is certainly playing a large role already in the transatlantic economy. Cross-border data flows between the US and Europe are the highest in the world. Europe and the United States need to work together to ensure that this digitally driven commercial activity has the opportunity to grow while remaining secure. Both the United States and Europe deeply respect the importance of data privacy in principle and in practice. However, we've developed philosophically different approaches to ensuring data privacy. In the EU, governments take a rights-based approach. Before transferring personal data outside of the EU, one must demonstrate to the EU that the transfer location has adequate data protection. The United States, on the other hand, takes a harm-based approach. We have sectoral regulations to protect against privacy breaches with respect to health records, financial data, and the like. Despite our differences, We've come together in recognition of the importance of keeping data flowing across our borders. We launched a